Good morning.
Good morning.
I'd like to welcome everyone to Faymont Baptist Church this morning. If we have any first-time visitors with us, I'd like to draw attention to the card in the pew back there in front of you. If you would, just take that card, fill it out, and turn it in at one of our welcome centers on your way out today. We have a special gift for you. Welcome centers are located through this door to my right, or either we have one out front on the way out the front doors. Also, just like to remind you during any of our songs this morning, if you have any tithes and offering, you can take those and come put them in the plates here in front of the pulpit. Tonight at 6 p.m. is our fall festival, which will be our trunk or treat around the walking trail. And everyone who has signed up, or if you haven't signed up, and you are available to bring your vehicle and set it up to pass out candy. The committee asks that you be here by 5 o'clock so that all the cars can be lined up around the track. And then afterwards, if you'd like to have a hot dog and some chips and something to drink, then you can participate in that, and we'll be ready for all the folks who are coming through so that we can be a witness to them at 6 o'clock. Remember, next Saturday, before you go to bed, turn your clocks back. Daylight saving time ends, so you know we'd love for you to be here early next week, but you know, we do want you to just be mindful of that, the daylight saving time ending next week. Also, we have Operation Christmas Child, that shoe boxes that we're gearing up for here at the church. Our church boxes are due next Sunday. If you have yet to get your box, or if you need some more, there are some located on both sides of the stage here, so please feel free to come and take all those that you need. Also, be mindful that our mission friends and GAs will continue to be taking up loose change until November the 21st, and all the monies that is collected through by them will be going to Operation Christmas Child shoeboxes to help cover the cost of shipping. Also, please remember that our Operation Christmas Child shoebox collection week is November 15th through the 22nd, so if you're able to volunteer for that, I know that those folks will greatly appreciate your help in coming out to help them, especially men. You know, if you're available around the 4 or 5 o'clock range, you know, you need some strong backs to help load up the 18-wheeler tractor trailers with all the boxes that have come in. And then also we have the Operation Christmas Child Shoebox Processing Center trips. There is a day trip that's planned for December the 3rd, and also there is a wait for December the 4th, so that possibly could be a two-day trip there. Then an adult trip is planned for December the 14th to 15th. That will be at the Charlotte Processing Center. And then our teens will be going to Boone on December the 17th and 18th to work at that processing center there. And so at this time, I think we've got an OCC video. And then after the video, I'm going to ask our Deacon of the Week, Mr. David Parker, if he would come and open us in prayer.
Then I said to the nobles, the rulers, and the rest of the people, the work is great and extensive, and we are separated far from one another on the wall. Wherever you hear the sound of the trumpet, rally to us there. Our God will fight for us.
Isn't it amazing that through a gift box, God has raised up intercessors and preachers? I believe the Lord is reminding us today that even in the midst of this pandemic, we are to look upon the nations, to observe, to be astonished, to wonder, because He is doing something mighty.
This calling to serve Jesus in this way is the rallying call. That's the sound of the trumpet, the urgency of this gospel that we get to serve, the urgency that He's calling us to introduce more and more people, more and more children, to a loving God through His Son, Jesus Christ.
Each of you and all of the many volunteers that you represent are the heart and soul and engine driving Operation Christmas Child. During this pandemic, the Lord has continued to encourage and to equip the local church and the body of Christ.
The idea that we could have collected more than 9 million shoebox gifts around the world in the middle of a pandemic, I believe is miraculous. Samaritan's Purse, Operation Christmas Child volunteers are rallying around the opportunity to share the gospel. We're rallying toward National Collection Week, where we seek to send another set of nearly 10 million gospel opportunities around the world.
We still have time, we still have opportunity. The Lord has not returned yet. And we want to keep pushing and going forward and doing whatever we can do to reach more, share with more, equip more, to share more.
When the mountain seems too big, the challenge seems way too big, the goal is way too big, God will go before us and fight our battles.
Now it's time. And Jesus said the fields are not white in 4 months, they're white today. And we want to be faithful to that. And that's the opportunity the Lord has given Samaritan's Purse and the Operation Christmas Child Project.
Stand up and we're going to praise God this morning. So let's go ahead and get started.
Here I am, God, arms wide open. church, lift your voices.
Here I am, God.
Your grace.
there your mercy and your grace was free. There your pardon multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. At Calvary.
Amen. Amen.
before I get started, I'd like to just give you a few words from Dr. White as he talked to me this morning. He is completely sorry that he couldn't be here this morning. He had to have a procedure Friday, and this morning he's not able to be here because of that procedure. But he did want me to tell you that that he has enjoyed his time here. You as a church have completely made him feel welcome and loved during his time here, and he was so forward looking to sharing that with you this morning. So he does send his apologies for not being able to be here because of that. And next week, Dr. Hash will be back with us, and he'll be leading us until the new pastor is found. So please be in prayer for that as he comes to lead us as a church next week. If you would, go ahead and turn in your Bibles to Mark chapter 17, and we'll be looking at verses 17 through 31 this morning. And I'm going to call this sermon, "The Man Who Had Two Things, Everything and Nothing." Have you ever left home and just had a funny feeling that you had forgotten something? Now, I think all of us probably have had that feeling. You know that there's just that feeling of nagging that's going on, that something's just not right. You know, you forgot something. There was this here family that every time that they started to go off traveling, they'd get down the road a few miles, and the wife would say, "Honey, I think I left the iron on. We need to go back and check to make sure that it's off so the house don't burn down." And so this kind of carried on for a few trips. And then finally one day as they were leaving to go out of town on vacation, she said, "Honey, I think I left the iron on. We need to go back and check it." And so the husband just pulled off to the side of the road and he walked around to the trunk, and he got something out, and he brought it back. He said, "Honey, here's your iron. You can cut it off." Our passage today actually will introduce us to a young man who was searching for something. You know, he's often called the rich young ruler. Over in Matthew, he tells us that he was a young man. Luke describes him as a ruler. And in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, they all tell us that he was rich. He was a man who had two things. He had everything, and he had nothing. He was wealthy and successful, but he turned away from Jesus with nothing. He was searching for something more in life. You know, millions of people are searching for something that they really can't even put their finger on what they're searching for. Now, back in 1987, Bono and the Irish rock group U2 recorded a song about this universal search. He sang, "I have run, I have crawled, I have scaled these city's walls only to be with you. But I still haven't found what I'm looking for." You know, and he goes on in the song to end it, referring to Jesus. He said, "You broke the bonds and you loosed the chains, carried the cross of my shame. Oh, my shame, you know I believe it. But I still haven't found what I'm looking for." You know, over the last few years, he's actually become very vocal about his faith and how he has placed his faith in Jesus Christ. And he makes it clear that what he was searching for all along was a relationship with Jesus Christ. Now, if you don't know, his real name was actually Paul Davison Houston. And he wears sunglasses indoors because he suffers from glaucoma. And he said, "Who is Christ is a defining question for a person." You know, you're not let off by just saying that he was a great thinker or a philosopher. He went around saying that he was the Messiah. He was crucified because he was the Son of God. He either was the Son of God or either he was just totally nuts. He said, and I find it hard to accept that millions of lives have felt their lives touched and inspired by some nut. 2,000 years ago, there was this young, wealthy, successful leader who came to Jesus who was looking for something. And that's where our text is going to come from this morning. If you would, please stand with me as we look at Mark 10, verses 17 through 31. And God's word says, as he was setting out on a journey, a man ran up, knelt down before him, and asked him, good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Why do you call me good? Jesus asked him. No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. Do not murder. Do not commit adultery. Do not steal. Do not bear false witness. Do not defraud. Honor your father and mother. He said to him, teacher, I have kept all these from my youth. Looking at him, Jesus loved him and said to him, you lack one thing. Go sell all you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come follow me. But he was dismayed by this demand, and he went away grieving because he had many possessions. Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, how hard is it for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God? The disciples were astonished at his words. Again, Jesus said to them, children, how hard is it to enter the kingdom of God? It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God. They were even more astonished, saying to one another, then who can be saved? Looking at them, Jesus said, with man it is impossible, but with God, because all things are possible with God. Peter began to tell him, look, we have left everything and followed you. Truly, I tell you, Jesus said, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for my sake and for the sake of the gospel who will not receive 100 times more now at this time. Houses, brothers and sisters, mothers and children and fields with persecutions and enter eternal life in the age to come. But many who are first will be last, and the last first. Dear Father, Lord, we come to you this morning, Father, thanking you for your word that gives us guidance, that gives us insight into the God that you are, and God that gives us instructions for life. Father, we ask that you would just allow your spirit to move here this morning, Father, that every word that comes from our mouth will be nothing more and nothing less. For it's in your holy and precious name we ask these things. Amen. You know, as we take a look at this scripture this morning, you know, it doesn't call out the name of the guy. So we're going to give him a name this morning. We're going to call him Ben, all right? So when I'm talking about Ben this morning, that's who we're talking about, Ben. And so as we're taking him, we're looking here as what's going on with Ben here, all right? Jesus is taking and he's starting to go out onto a journey. And here comes, you know, Ben up to him, all right? And he says, Jesus, tell me one thing. What must I do to inherit eternal life? You know, there's a lot of people out there today who are going around asking the question, what must I do in order to gain eternal life? And it's us, it's you and I that have to have the answer. Because listen, the world's not going to give them the answer that they need. You and I will be the ones who are giving them the answer. And folks, as we'll see a little bit later on, there's only one way that they can inherit that eternal life. But you know, I want you to take and kind of look right there at what Jesus kind of gives him. And you know, it's just kind of a odd answer that Jesus gives him. He says, you know the commandments. Now, folks, in the Jewish day, the Jews knew what the Ten Commandments were. They knew what the law was. That's what they strived to live by. And yet, the answer from this guy is, Jesus, I've done that since my youth. Now, take it and look at the Ten Commandments, or the commandments that Jesus gave there. Now, I want to kind of pull back just a little bit here, all right, and just kind of go back to the Ten Commandments. As you look at the Ten Commandments, they are separated into kind of two categories. One is our relationship with God, and second, our relationship with those around us, or that deal kind of with us. All right, the ones that take action from us. And I want you to notice right there that Jesus reads out, do not murder, do not commit adultery, do not steal, do not bear false witness, do not defraud, and honor your father and mother. Now, do you notice that there's one thing that's missing there? That there's one commandment that deals with relationships with others and our action toward others that's missing. Thou shalt not covet. Why would Jesus leave that out to this rich young ruler? You know, he had everything. Anything that he wanted. And so I feel like, you know, the Bible doesn't say this, but I feel like that because of the stature, because of all of his possessions that he had, Jesus didn't mention that to him. And so as Jesus is telling him these things and he's answering, Ben thinks that he's good because he's kept all these commandments. But then what Jesus says to him next is look. And I want you to notice the word right there. Jesus loved him. Now, remember, this guy hasn't received eternal life. But yet Jesus still loved him. And that's a picture for those of you who have not accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. All right, he still loves you, even though you have accepted him as your Lord and Savior. In fact, with you and I who have accepted him as our Lord and Savior, all right, he loved us before we were ever born. Before we accepted him as our Lord and Savior, he loved us. I mean, can you imagine someone who has given their life for you and yet you're not even born? Sounds odd, doesn't it? But Jesus loves us that much. And Jesus looks at him after he looked at him with love there, and he says, you lack one thing. Go sell all you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come follow me. Can you imagine if someone walked up to you and said, if you want to have eternal life, you've got to go sell all your possessions? Folks, how many of us would be willing to sell our house? How many of us would be willing to sell our cars? How many of us would be willing to give up our jobs? It's basically what Jesus is telling this rich ruler here. He's telling him, listen, get rid of all of it. You know why Jesus calls us to give up everything when we follow him? It's because he's going to supply everything that we will ever need in our life if we'll just be obedient to him and follow him. It says you get rid of your earthly treasures, I'll give you heavenly treasures. And once you do that, you will come and follow me. And Ben, in hearing that he's got to sell all his jewelry, he's got to sell all of his possessions, his house, his car, well, actually his horse and chariot, because he probably didn't have a car back then. But he had to get rid of all of that. And he went away dejected, kind of went away grieving. It says because he had many possessions. Does that not speak to you and I this morning? With all the things that we have, are we willing to give those up? Or does it make us sad that Jesus is asking us to give those things up? Now, I'm not telling you to go home and sell everything you got today, okay? But if God's telling you to go home and do it, then you need to do it. And then the scene that takes place right there afterwards, as Jesus sees Ben going off and kind of feeling dejected and grieving, he looks around at his disciples. I mean, the men who have been with him his whole journey of ministry here on this earth, he looks around at these guys and says, how hard is it for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom? And they look around with astonishment. I mean, they're astonished that Jesus has just told this guy that he's got to go, and now he's asking them, guys, you've been with me all these years. What is it that a person must do in order to enter into the kingdom of God? And they're astonished. Jesus sees the expression on their face, all right, and he addresses them again, and this time he says, children. Whenever you're trying to get your child's attention, aren't they sometimes a little hard-headed? I mean, that's the picture I see right here that Jesus is seeing in his disciples. I mean, here he is. He's been with them. He's taught them. This is stuff that they should know. And so he's got to get their attention. And he says, children, how hard is it to enter the kingdom of God? So he's asked them again, but he goes on and says a little bit more, all right? And some people just kind of call this the camel joke, okay? He says, it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God. Kind of strange thing to say, isn't it? A camel can go through the needle of an eye better than a rich person can enter the kingdom of God. Listen, I want to say this to you this morning. The solution that God has for each and every one of us in the situation that we're in is that he has a unique solution for. The solution that he has for you is not the solution that he's going to have for me. And that's what he's trying to say here in this verse, that it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of the needle than it is for a rich person to enter the kingdom of heaven. Now listen, I'm not saying if you're rich that you're not going to be able to enter the kingdom of heaven. No, it's whenever you take and you put those possessions and you put your wealth and everything else ahead of God, right, and you don't have that relationship with Jesus Christ, that you're not able to enter. He knows that those who have the wealth that and those who have possessions and those folks kind of take it and hold them close to them. He knows it's going to be hard for those folks to let that stuff go. And so that's why he says what he says about the camel. So we have to be obedient to God. And when he said that, they were even more astonished. And they said, well, then, Jesus, if that's the case, then who can be saved? Everybody's going to have possessions. Everybody's going to have a little bit of money. Maybe a nickel, not a million, but everybody's going to have a little bit. So then, who can be saved? Look at his response there. He says, looking at them, Jesus said, with man, it is impossible. Folks, listen. There's nothing you and I can do that can give us our salvation. You can't be good enough. You can't be rich enough. You can't be wealthy enough. You can't have enough possessions. You can't give away enough of your possessions in order to get salvation. It's impossible for you and I to do anything to enter the kingdom, to be able to enter the kingdom of heaven. And Jesus goes on. All things are possible with God. All things are possible with God. See, as I was saying, Jesus has a different solution for you and I. Now, there's only one way, but the way that you come to receive salvation, the way that Jesus Christ allows you a way out of this world and have eternal life with Him is different. See, Jesus designs a solution for each person. So we see here with this ruler, he's wanting to know what he can do to get into heaven. And Jesus says, go and sell everything that you have. What is your solution this morning for you? I can tell you one thing that it contains is obedience to God. Obedience to the Holy Spirit speaking to you this morning to make that commitment to make Jesus Lord of your life. All things are possible with God. Peter began to look at him. He said, we've left everything and followed you. Peter said, we've left our possessions. We have nothing left. We've left our families, our mother, our father. We've left our brothers, our sisters. We've left our house. We left our boats. We left the fish in the boats. We left it all. And Jesus says, those who have left all those things will receive 100 times more now at this time. And he goes through the list again and says, he adds one thing, he says, and persecutions. Folks, listen. When we're obedient to God, when we do what he tells us to do, people's going to make fun of us. People's going to look down on us. People are going to demean us. But we know that when we're following God and those things are happening, we know that that is just the tactics of Satan. Jesus goes on and says, because you've done these things, you will also receive eternal life in the age to come. Jesus has been teaching his disciples about the things that were to come. You know, a couple of weeks ago, whenever we looked at it, you know, Jesus had to tell them three times. And it was even still as they were not getting what was going to happen. But Jesus says, when that time comes, you're going to have eternal life in the age to come. Whenever Jesus comes back to rapture us, folks, all these things that we worry about, we'll never have to worry about again. Because everything will be made perfect again. And then Jesus finishes up speaking to his disciples there with another crazy saying. Those who prefer to be first shall be last, and the last first. Now, folks, I don't know if after church, when you make that mad dash to K&W, if you're in the back of the line, you're not first, are you? Jesus is saying, if you want to be first, you've got to be last. You know, this is basically showing the heart of Jesus, the heart of a servitude, a heart of being a servant, of putting those before you, putting others before you. You want to be great? Be at the end of the line. He says, the last will be first. So what about you here this morning? Let me ask you, if you know who this Jesus is that we're talking about, there was a billionaire, a few years back, that was doing an interview with Focus on the Family, and the reporter asked him, said, do you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? And his answer was, you know, I give some of my money toward this charity, and I give some money here, and I try to treat these people this way, and I treat these people this way. They're all, you know, doing good things for them. And after he went on about all the things he were doing, the nice things, the reporter looked back at him and said, do you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? And his answer was, you know, I'm really not sure, but I do all these things. Try to keep Jesus in the picture. Folks, it's not about bringing God into the picture, because he is the picture. And there's only one way that we can approach God, and that is with humility and the admission that we are lost without his forgiveness. Now, theoretically, there are three ways that you can get to heaven. One is that you die before the age of accountability. You're all here this morning, and I assume that you understand what I'm saying. So you've passed that window. You're now in the age of accountability. So that one's marked off. The second way is that you live a perfect life. That means that you never do anything bad, you never do anything wrong. You live a perfect life. Folks, I know that's not us. You know me and I know you. We're not perfect. So scratch that one off. The third way is that we put our trust and our faith in Jesus Christ. We make Him Lord of our life. That's the only option that you and I have this morning, is to accept that free gift of salvation in order to get eternal life. You know, Ben had so much, but he ended up with nothing but the God of wealth in his life. You know, there may be some of you here this morning that's that has another God that's competing with ruling your life. But Jesus is here. He's wanting to take it and to give you that good life. He loves you. And He wants to spend eternity with you this morning. Or when you die, not this morning, but He wants you to have the opportunity to spend eternity with Him. So as our music starts to play, Brother Tim comes and play, maybe you don't know who this Jesus is. And you're not sure about whether you have accepted Him as your Lord and Savior, then this morning I ask that you come down. I'll be here if you need a couple of deacons, they'll be here so that you can speak with them too. They'll come forward. Or maybe you have accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior and you've just not been living the life that shows that He's Lord of your life. And you need to make a recommitment to Him this morning. Then I urge you to do that. There's only one way. Through Jesus. And if we have Him, we should do our very best to make Him Lord of our life. If you would please stand, bow your heads, close your eyes. You respond however God is leading you this morning. The altar is open. If you've got something you want to come and place at the foot of the cross, you do that. But respond however the Holy Spirit is leading you here this morning.
Thank you.
for being here this morning, and just like to remind you about the Fall Festival tonight. Please be here by 5 o'clock to park your cars, all right, and then get you a little bit of food so that you can have plenty of energy to keep up with all those kids coming through this evening. All right, at this time, I want to ask Brother Rick if he would to close us in prayer.